Okay. Yeah, well, welcome everyone. It's the time of the season to look back, to what has come to pass. Now, on television, they look back on the previous year mostly. Now, here, Martin van Hornbeck will give us a look at what was going on in terms of, well, as I understand it, exploits and funny hacks in the last 3 years, from 2005 to 2007. So look at the title and expect meaty martial arts.
Hello everyone, guten Abend. I knew the dragon was popular, but I didn't expect it to be that popular though. Good evening, everyone. For all of you who saw us playing around with PowerPoint and Windows to get this up on the screen, I'm terribly sorry, but I could hardly come here with Keynote and then give a presentation called Crouching PowerPoint. Hope you understand. Okay, so what I'll be talking to you about this evening is mainly targeted attacks. So that means not 98% of all the Trojans that you can find out there that are interested in stealing your banking details, but really the ones that are used for, let's say, even less benign purposes. They've been in the news quite a bit over the last year. There's been a lot of talk about targeted attacks against nations, especially Germany, actually. There's also been a lot of talk about targeted attacks being used for other purposes. And tonight, I hope to reveal a little bit of what those attacks can do and actually how they're being employed in real life. To give you a bit of an overview of what I'll be talking about this evening, first of all, we'll have a look at information operations. Now, I understand this may be a bit of a boring 10 to 15 minutes for most of you. But it's just an overview of what information operations are. You hear a lot of talk about information warfare. What is it really? How is it being used? How does it relate to actual attacks that are taking place on the internet? We'll have a look at some of the tactics that are used there, some cultural differences. What is information operations in the US? What is information operations in China, for example? And have a look at how they can be translated into real-life attacks on the internet. Then we'll look at one specific targeted attack that took place from somewhere in the beginning of 2005 and is actually still taking place today. We'll have a look at the issue space, so what is really happening, who are the parties involved, have an overview at the individual attacks as they took place, and finally I'll show you a bit of a link analysis of the different objects and subjects that are involved in the attack. You'll see more about that later. And then finally, we'll have a very brief look at how to defend against these dark arts. What are the technical controls we can put in place? And finally, there's one thing that I really think is not really a solution, but a good approach to dealing with these incidents, and that's security intelligence. And I'll give you a bit more insight into that. And then we'll have some time for Q&A. Just 2 minutes about myself, or hopefully much less. My name is Maarten van Hornbeek. I come here from Belgium, and during the day I'm a security consultant. In the evenings and when I have time off, I enjoy looking into things that most companies look at as being residual risk. So the things that they take into account that can happen, but they mainly consider it out of their control and they insure against it, for example. But this is really what this talk will be about. So I hope you enjoy the next hour. Usually I like to give a bit of an informal presentation so that you can interrupt me and everything, but since I have way too many slides, I have to admit this, I propose that we keep questions till the end, and at that point in time, I'll definitely make time for questions. And if there are still questions after that, then just come to me. I'm here for the full 4 days, so you can always bother me. To give a very quick introduction into information operations does require a bit of a start in what is information and how is it being used. And I always like to compare this or compare the past with the village and the future and today with the city. Just because in 2007, or as of 2007, more than 50% of the world's population now lives in cities. So that means that there's been a big cultural change over the last couple of hundred years, and it's very important also from an information perspective. When you look at the village, or rather what the village meant, in a village you generally have very fixed roles. You have people living there that have jobs that are actually fairly common. Every village, for example, has its baker, every village has its butcher. You have different types of jobs in every village, but generally they're the same. Also, between villages, you just have the little roads that you can take by car, but they're not really very common ways or very good ways of transporting a lot of information. So the village was really a place where we had all these people doing jobs that were very well known, and the content of the jobs was pretty much common. Like every bakery did sort of the same thing. They made some small changes, but nothing really radical because there was a baker in every village. Today, however, we moved to something completely different. We moved to the city. And in the city, you have very strong communication links. In this picture, you can see the ocean. The ocean was, in human history, one of the biggest ways of actually getting things across. For example, when all of Japan was actually blocked off from foreigners, the Dutch were still able to get to Japan and trade with them due to their experience in shipping and trade overseas. Information in a city has very unpredictable properties. You have a lot of people in cities that do the same job, but they have very unique selling propositions. Everyone does something for a different reason, and everyone has different specialties. So the value of information really depends on time, on the situation, on the people involved. Now, another very important piece of information operations, really a ground rule, is that reality does not exist. Reality is constructed. Every one of you has a very different view of what is happening here today. You've seen the same talks, but still you have different ideas of those talks. Some of you may like this talk, some of you may absolutely hate it. And that's really the same for everything. And that's because we really construct reality based on a couple of ground rules, and that was very well described by John Boyd, which was an Air Force officer in the US, who discovered something or wrote up something what he calls the OODA loop, and it's based on what a pilot does when he gets into his airplane. He observes what is happening, he orients himself based on what he sees. During orientation, he looks at his own cultural tradition, at new information that he gets in on what he achieved in life, what he has done, what he feels proud of. Then he makes a hypothesis of what is happening. He decides what he's going to do, and he takes action. And when he's taken action, he goes back to the beginning, he observes what is happening, and he can change what he's doing. So information is very important in how we construct reality and what we do. Now, the problem with this OODA loop is that it also very, very well signifies what can be attacked when you construct reality, when you think about reality. You can do three things. You can deny certain pieces of information, you can deceive people by feeding them information, which is incorrect, and you can destroy pieces of information that are important. And by doing each one of those things, you can actually make very important changes into how they perceive reality and how they make decisions. And that's really what all these new social engineering attacks that we're seeing today are dealing with. Banking Trojans, for example. A lot of banking Trojans actually get installed by being run through a user that is persuaded to click on an attachment, for example, because it relates to a news item. So this image, this OODA loop by John Boyd, which I blatantly stole here from Patrick Edwin Moran, I didn't draw this myself. This OODA loop very well signifies what can go wrong in the decision-making process and how people can abuse it. And this is very important in information operations, because what you're trying to do there is you're trying to make to have people make decisions that you want them to make, even though they may not be in the subject's best interest. So what is information operations really? In the US, they have a very nice definition for it. This comes from the Joint Doctrine for Information Operations. They call it the integrated employment of the core capabilities of electronic warfare, computer network operations, psychological operations, military deception and operation security, with specified supporting and related capabilities to influence automated decision making while protecting our own. Now that takes a bit of effort to just say, but it is a very good definition of what it should be. However, when you talk to American military personnel on information operations, they mainly focus on computer network operations. And computer network operations is what we perceive as, for example, hacking or even protecting our own information. The goal of information operations is to achieve an information advantage. So you want to have better information than your competitor, and you can do that by protecting your own information or by attacking the information of the other party, and you can do that by denying, deceiving, and destroying all these nice goodies. There A main interest in the US for the moment in information operations is in coordinating execution. In 2006, I believe, there was a declassified information operations roadmap in the US, and that one really focuses on coordination, because the US is one of those countries where you actually have a lot of different militaries. You have the Army, you have the Air Force, you have the Navy, and all of those need to be coordinated. And of course, there's a lot of quarreling between the different groups on who should be doing what and what is really important in the big picture. How do other countries deal with it? A good example is China. In China, in the beginning of the 90s, there were a lot of different definitions on information warfare. A lot of them were copied from the US definitions. There were also a lot of them that were grown from the country itself. But one thing that has popped up in the more limited set of definitions that exists today is that most do not deal with victory. In essence, Chinese military doctrine is not interested with victory. They're interested with control. They want to control what the other party is doing to ensure that decision-making is in their advantage. Also, these definitions usually take into account people's war, which is a concept really thought out by Mao Zedong, and the concept actually deals with making sure that your enemy is attracted to you, so that instead of fighting somewhere else, you fight internally, but you make sure that your population actually supports your cause, so that the population is able to help you in actually protecting the country. And that's also very visible in some of the Chinese definitions today. And then very interesting are the stratagems. The stratagems are really tools of deception that have been devised over 300 years ago, and they're still, well, I wouldn't say in use, but they're still very well studied in Chinese military today. There are about 36 stratagems, and they're really very short sentences that describe a certain type of deception paradigm. For example, this is one of them: deceive the sky to cross the ocean. Deceiving the sky to cross the ocean means that you want to make sure that whomever is looking sees something that looks completely benign, let's say an email. And at the same time, you can cross the ocean and you can do whatever you want, but from above, it looks very normal and it doesn't look like an attack. These deception devices are really quite interesting. You can find all of them on the internet. There are 36 sentences that really describe unique pieces of deception, and I really love them, because if you read the US doctrines on information operations, they really say this is the procedure to go about doing deception, and then it starts describing what is necessary to think about when you're doing deception. But none of them are really as clever as these 36 stratagems, so if you ever have time, look them up. It really is a pleasant read. So that's really it for information operations, but the reason why I wanted to give you that 5-minute introduction is because it really links into the rest of this presentation quite well. In this presentation, we'll look at targeted attacks, and targeted attacks usually have as goal to gain access to information, information that is valuable to you, that you can use to gain an information advantage from your competitor. And that's why the previous description really links in very well to what we'll be looking at right now. Of course, if you're doing a targeted attack, you need a methodology to do so. And most attack methodologies today seem to be modeled something like this, really. First of all, you identify the data that you're interested in gathering. So suppose that you want to have information on someone's whereabouts. You might want to have a look at his email to find out whether he has any schedule for that day, or you might want to look at his calendar. So you identify what information is valuable. In some cases, this may be, for example, where you have a group of people that work together in a forum on the internet that exchange information there. You can easily see on those forums who is really meaningful, who has good ideas, who is coming up with all the new stuff that everyone else follows. And so you can really identify who is important on a forum or a web portal and who has the information that you might be interested in. So you look for concentrations of information that you're interested in. You go to the forums, you go to web portals, you look for companies that are interesting. Then you look for those subjects of influence that really pull those companies together or pull that information together and make it useful. You can do that by crawling the website. You can do it by talking to people. Last week, there was even some talk about this Russian bot that was able to fake a human being so that it could actually gain some information from people, which is really quite a novel concept. You can also get it through social networking. A lot of times you can get useful information from things like LinkedIn and all of these other social networks. You can gather information on who has certain data, because generally people who know something about a subject, they really want to brag about it a little bit, or at least they share it with other people because they think it, well, because of course it's interesting for the other people to learn about that subject.